want to welcome the man of God, Pastor Miguel, to the house of the Lord. God bless you. Come on, you can do better than that. Praise Jesus.
And I would like you to open your scriptures in the book of Philippians. We put a few verses on the poster. Amen. That my brother George or Team CFM prepared. Hallelujah. In Philippians chapter 2, we want to read two verses. And as we read, we will be speaking about these verses and ministering to you through these verses. Hallelujah. Philippians chapter 2, if you have it, you may say amen. Amen. And we're going to read just two verses to the glory of the Father, the Son, and with the manifestation and the power of His Holy Spirit. And all of God's people say, amen. If you want to stand up, you may. If you want to reverence the Lord by standing up to the word of God, you may. The power of God is held back waiting, all right? I'm going to wait. The Holy Spirit is there hovering over the waters. The waters are there. The blessing is there. They're convinced. There's salvation. There's repentance. But He's hovering over the marriage to wait until they come into an agreement. Because if He pours Himself over one and the other one is not in agreement, you know what's going to happen? There's going to be a division. And when there's a division, Satan cuts off half of your ministry and ruins your future in the power of God. He knows he can't face you in the ministry. He can't face you when you're in front preaching and serving the Lord and fasting and praying, but he's going to try through your marriage. He can't touch your marriage. He's going to try through your children. He can't touch your children. He's going to try through the friends of your children. He can't touch the friends of your children. He's going to start trying with the leaders of the church around you. One way or another, he's going to try to split, divide, conquer. And that's where the Word of God says we have to be like-minded. One accord. One agreement. If you don't have an agreement at home, it's going to be hard for you to have an agreement in the church. Is there anybody listening? If there's no agreement, can you make me some scrambled eggs? No, I'm going to make you some boiled eggs. I just asked you if you could, honey, can you make me scrambled eggs? I would like scrambled. No, I'm already made boiled eggs. Prepare yourself. See, in these little things, you could see disagreements. And you could see rebellions. And you could see areas where... And women and men, sometimes they don't see it, but in here and in here, they're blocked. But you see it in the decision-making at home and the mutual agreement in the kitchen and the home and the cleaning and the doing the bed. You can see these areas of division where Satan is ready to break up a marriage. Is there anybody listening? Being like-minded. Then he says, having... the same love. When it speaks about love, it's not speaking about your eros, erotic love in a marriage love. No. When it's speaking about love here in this word, it's not speaking about filios love, a love that you're brought up in the family and you're used to that brother, sister love and that love you grow up with mommy and daddy and you receive that love from. No, it's speaking about agape love. It's speaking about love that you receive from God And that when you receive it from God, you have a responsibility to share it with others. Or do you think that God's going to pour out love agape over you for you to keep it inside your heart and your mind and share it only with your partner? No. The Lord is looking for marriages that represent His kingdom. For marriages that are willing to stand on the gap, stand in the middle and say, Lord, here I am. Where are the broken down marriages so I could help correct their mistakes? So I could help guide them, Father. Where are the marriages that are troubled up so I could stand in the gap? And Lord, any anger that I stand in the middle. And listen to this. When I stand on the gap for marriages, you know what happens in my marriage? I'm attacked. When I pray for miscommunication in other marriages, you know what happens in my marriage? Miscommunication. When I pray and I fast for the marriages, Lord, that they be one, that you put like-minded, one mind, one heart, one love, Lord, in them, Father, that you bless them. And I'm praying and fasting for the marriages. You know what's gonna come to you? When you stand on the gap, let me give you an example. When you stand on the gap, Father, I'm praying for Brother George and Sister Megan. Bless them, Lord. Put a baby, Lord, in their marriage. Yeah, hallelujah. What a blessing. And you stand in the middle and you're praying for them. Lord, put unity, put blessing over this marriage, Father. And if they have an argument and you're standing in the gap in intercession and pray for them, you know what's going to come to you? That spirit that pushes them to argue and fight and contend is going to come through you and present itself to you because you decided to stand in the gap before God in front of them and say, Lord, have mercy over this marriage. Bless this marriage. I'm standing in the gap for this marriage. And whatever contention or whatever evil spirit comes against them is going to come against you because you decided to stand in the gap for them. 101 intercession classes. You don't just pray and everything is beautiful. When you pray and you intercede, you're going to be attacked. You pray for marriages, your marriage is going to be attacked. You better have agape love. Because if you don't have agape love, you're going down. You will hit divorce. You will be shredded and taken apart. But if you have agape love, the fight will come, the problem, the contention, the evil spirits will try to trouble you. They will try to divide you, but you have agape love. And when you think she doesn't deserve my love because she disrespected me, you remember the word of God that says you have to give love to who doesn't deserve love. And you say, Lord, I want to be spiritual. I don't want to be carnally minded. I want to be spiritual. I want to give more than I receive, Lord. And you start paying a price in intercession and sharing with others. And when you bless other marriages, you know what they're going to start doing with the marriages around them? The same thing you do with them. God is going to put other marriages around them for them to share the same advice, the same example, the same love you give to them. Intercession. Having the same love, the same agape. The word agape is, it means a feast. You know, have you ever been to Mandarin? You look like a big boy. You like putting in some proteins and, You look like you could handle Mandarin buffet, huh? Huh, brother? Did I just call you out? You go to the buffet in Mandarin and you're eating all sorts of stuff. Amen. So, according to the word of God, one of the descriptions of agape love is a buffet or a banquet of affection. I want you to say to someone beside you, we need more affection. We need more affection. Amen. If you were to ask my wife who's more affectionate in our marriage, she has to point at me. Because I have the prize, number one prize of being affectionate. Yes or no? Lift your hand though. Yes or no? I'm an affectionate person. I need affection. I need to be touching my wife's hair, her face. No, don't touch my face. I'm touching her neck. I'm touching her shoulder, her arm. I'm touching her hand. And then I reach her hand and I put it on mine. And she's like, one, two, three, done. What? I'm investing time here giving you affection. I want affection too. Hear me out. I want affection. You know, I sell myself out for affection. When my wife scratch, it's like a little dog scratches my ear. I start going. I start moving. She does things to me when she touches me around here. But it's things that only your partner knows. If someone in church comes to me and gives me a kiss and blesses me and touches me here, I'm going to rebuke them in the name of... I rebuke that in Jesus. That's only my wife can touch me there. That's reserved for my wife. Amen? And there's things that are only for the husband and the wife. And I want you to understand that there's things you have to keep in the marriage. Don't make the mistake of bringing them out. Keep them in the marriage. My father taught me never to speak about sexual things outside of the marriage. Don't you make the mistake, church, of speaking about sexual intimacy outside of your marriage. Keep it in the marriage. You have nothing to speak about sexual intimacy outside of your marriage. Take care of what God has given to you. That's your treasure. Don't open it up in front of other people. They can desire and covet what you have. And adultery spirits move in this fashion, this way. People speak a little bit about their sexual life and there's adulterous spirits listening. This is a way in. Be careful. Keep your marriage a secret in the intimacy. That's you and the Lord. And if you bow your knees down to the Lord and you need advice or you need something to season up your marriage, speak to the Lord in secret and the Lord will send someone in secret to help you. Because the Lord moves people to help and edify his people. Amen? And you have to learn that the marriage is sacred before the Lord. There's people that come to me, pastor, the marriage is in the... Hold up. I want to help you, but first let's get together with the marriage. Don't talk to me alone, together. You know, because sometimes one tends to exaggerate what the other one does. And when they're alone, they speak a lot. But when you get them together, they're like, what was it you wanted to say? Nothing, pastor. What do you mean nothing? You were giving me a whole sermon the other day. Now we make the meeting and you're so quiet. I didn't say anything. Get them together. Sometimes all they need is someone to hear them out so they can express, confess, and deliver themselves of things they've been going through. And the pastor's job is to intercede. Hello? Intercede for them. Lord, bless them. Pour out more love over them. Teach them that I may be an example to them, Father. Being like-minded, having the same love. Being of one accord. You know, when you say being of one accord, Christians, I don't know, they naturally think it's, riding my Honda Accord. No. Being of one accord means you have to be in a mutual agreement. Mutual agreement means let's speak. Let's get into an agreement. Let's dream together. Let's get into an agreement. Let's think things over. What's your plans? What's my plans? Let's come into an agreement. Let's fulfill this. Amen. Let's walk towards our destiny with God first. If it's his will, this will work out. If it's not his will, it won't work out. Amen. Whatever he desires, we can have plans. But if he's not in the middle of those plans, it won't work out. Amen. I'm sorry to burst your bubble, but it won't work out. You have to put the Lord number one first. of one mind. It first it says being like-minded, and then it says of one mind. When it comes to one mind, I were to take you to Psalms 133 verse 1. Psalms 133 verse 1 speaks about the unity of the brethren. Amen. It speaks about a unity, hallelujah, that not everyone has and not everyone understands. Amen. But what it says is, praise Jesus. 133 says, behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. And I want you to pay attention where it says unity at the end of the verse. There's an exclamation mark. So in other words, the word behold is all in capital letters. This is a shout. Behold! Listen to this. Let's get into acting here. How good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. He mentions two things, how good and how pleasant it is. Amen. It's good and it's pleasant when we are in unity of spirit. You could be in a church and there can be one person that's against the unity. Amen. The pastor says, or the leader says, oh, let's do a potluck dinner and let's all get together. And there's one that says, no, let's go somewhere else and eat. Did you just hear? Maybe you didn't hear me. The sister over there, I didn't ask her to cook. I just said we can all do a potluck dinner and share. And no, I don't want to cook today. They're like bitter. And sister, is there a problem? No, let's go to the restaurant better. We don't have to be washing dishes. Okay, I get the message. You wash a lot of dishes, sister. Contrary spirits. The pastor proposes, the leader proposes. And there's always someone that has an opinion contrary to what is proposed. That is a contrary spirit. It's easy to discern them. The pastor says, hey, two steps to the right. Hey, come on, Latinos, two steps to the right. And the other, they're doing steps the other way. Everyone's going this way, but there's one that's going the other way. Hello. That's a contrary dance spirit. I don't know what you would call that. Maybe they don't know where north or east or left and right is. Like the children in Nineveh, they don't know how to discern between right and left, right or wrong. Amen. But it's easy to discern the contrary spirit. So when the pastor shows up, they're always there. The pastor isn't there and they're shining and smiley. The pastor shows up and they get like mad and they want to sit down. Contrary spirits. You have to know who is in a contrary spirit in your congregation. Because if there's someone in a contrary spirit, he's holding back the unity of the spirit in the church. And it can be pleasant and it can be beautiful because in the flock the Lord put, there's one that God wants you to deal with. And the more you don't deal with it, the more that contrary spirit is going to start. It's contagious. Starts dealing with others. And then next, you didn't deal with it next week and it's three contrary spirits. You don't sit down and deal with them and draw their attention. The third week and it's five contrary spirits. All in agreement. All in a mutual agreement. And that's where we have to be careful and catch the foxes that try to ruin the vineyard. Amen? It says here, it is like the precious oil upon the head. It gives you two likes in this chapter. It is like the precious oil, amen, upon the head, running down on the beard of Aaron, running down it on the edge of his garments. And then he says, and that represents, hallelujah, the priest, the leader, the anointing of the leader when they are chosen and anointed to be leaders. Amen. When they are tested. I don't know CFM, but in our church, I test the deacons out. I put them to work. I see how their hearts are. I send people, go praise them a little, you know, bring them up. Tell them they're good leaders. Tell them they're the best. Tell them they should be the pastors. Yeah, I see them reactions. Not everybody's ready to be a deacon. There's some that puff up and say, oh, I'm better than Pastor Lynn. I could take care of this flock. Ooh, be careful. You're under the umbrella of Pastor Lynn. Be careful. You have to fulfill the order Pastor Lynn puts in this council because it's the vision God gave him. You need to submit to the order God gave him. You don't fulfill that order, you need to go to another council. Don't be a contrary spirit. Or you humble yourself, or you walk out. Amen? And go somewhere else. And avoid causing a division. Amen? I test the deacons first. Like the word of God says, put them to the test. Try them out. See how they are. See what's in their hearts. And if I see they come out right, and they have integrity, and they're faithful, and they're loyal, because I would see all of these things in the world with people that didn't have Christ. How much more if we have Christ in the church should we be able to see integrity, loyalty, and faithfulness? In church, we should see it more often and stronger, with a stronger bond. And when I see, okay, they passed the test, they didn't pass it, I correct them. I deal with them. I teach them. They passed the test, 1, 2, 3, all right. 1 year, 2 years, we're gonna name you a deacon. We're going to prepare you. Amen? But it takes time. This is not just 1 week to another. You're a deacon. You're the leader. Let's do it. You're the one in charge. Unless the Spirit of God anoints you and tells you, do it, anoint them, that's the one I'm going to use. I'll worry about everything. Praise God. If your word is given, I trust you. Whatever happens along the way, I'm trusting you. Amen? So the anointing, the two areas of the double portion of the Spirit. First, the anointing, the oil. When God chooses you and pours oil over you. I don't know about you, but I was poured oil in dreams. I had experiences in dreams where the Lord took me from my room, and I've never testified this before. I'm going to testify today where I had here in Montreal, where I had revelations where the Lord would come, an angel would come, pick me off my bed, take me to heaven, put me over a cloud. I'm standing there like, Lord, what is this? This is crazy. And angels coming to me out of an order of the voice of the Lord saying, anoint him with oil from head to toes. And then they bring me down to my bed, and my bed was full of oil. I wake up, and the bed was full of oil. Lord, this was spiritual. Was this real? I felt the air. I felt me going through the ceiling. I felt the breeze. I felt the clouds. I felt everything. Was this real? And after this, I started experimenting the power of God in different levels. One spiritual journey I had. The anointing is one part of the double portion. The second part of the double portion. Listen to this. It is like, verse 3, it is like the dew of Hermon descending upon the mountains of Zion, for there the Lord commanded the blessing life forevermore. So the dew of Hermon is the second part of the double portion of the Spirit. You could be anointed with oil from above. But if you don't separate time, let me explain this. The dew of Hermon comes over the mountains of Israel only when the sun still doesn't come up. Only at nighttime. Only at nighttime. Before the sun comes up, the dew of Hermon moves around. It's a thick cloud that has that has water or moist in it. And this cloud moves around and it provides water. It provides moisture to the plants, to the vegetation, to everything. And when people go up to the mountain to pray and they're being touched with the mountain of dew, this is the double portion of the Spirit. When you separate time to pray in the early morning or night, you separate time, you and the Lord alone, that dew comes over you. Whatever you pray for, the Lord will act up on it. That's the second portion. You might be anointed, but you need to seek that second part of the anointing. Amen. The second portion. It's like the oil being poured over Aaron, but it's also like the dew of Hermon that goes over the mountains of Jerusalem, of Israel. Amen. So we have to pay a price in communion, in a relationship, in prayer with the Lord. For the Lord to open doors, for the Lord to use you, for the Lord to push you in the spirit, in the gifts, in the ministry, you need to learn to bow your knees down and seek him alone. Not with this, not with that, not with you alone, one-on-one time. In the secret place. Raise you up and show you secret things amongst the church. One-minded, one accord, one feeling, one spirit. When the Lord sees all these things, he starts sending eternal life to that place. He sends families. He sends people to set their eyes on you because you are the example he was looking for. You're reflecting his word. You're reflecting his face. You're reflecting his anointing, his power, his teachings. He's going to send others to put their eyes on you to follow you. Because the Lord knows you're going to bring them to him. They're going to follow you for a while, but then you got to teach them to go with him. Just like John the Baptist. He was walking with two of his disciples and they saw Jesus. And John the Baptist said, "Hey, there's the Lamb of God, the one that takes the sin out of the world. Follow him." He gave an order to his personal disciples. And he said, that's the one that has power. Me? Follow him. Right away, they followed Jesus. They submitted to what John the Baptist said. Because he knew that Jesus was the anointed one, the Son of God, the Lamb of God that was going to take the sin away from the world. And right away he gave the order, they submitted, they followed. Jesus made two disciples to teach them even more things that they had to learn. Our purpose in life is not for me to have my disciples and you to have your disciples, Pastor Lynn to have his disciples. Our purpose in the ministry is to prepare disciples for him. Did you hear that? For him. That's the purpose of the calling of the Lord. I don't work for selfish ambition. I don't work for me. I work for my family. We go out together. The church will help the church. We help each other out. We're together. We're a family. Someone's hungry, we have to help provide food. Someone needs gas for the car to move in, let's provide gas. Let's help each other. Today it's for you, tomorrow it's for us. This is what one agreement, one accord, one mind is for, to work together. It's the only way the church will grow if we are in one agreement, one accord. I want to stop right here. I want to tell you something. I was praying for the church. I've been praying for this church specifically. This church. And the Church of Toronto. And I want to tell you a revelation I had. As I was praying early in the morning, seeking the dew of Hermon. As I'm praying for this church. And for the Church in Toronto. And I want you to listen to this. And the Lord gave me a revelation. Where I saw two angels over a building. And the building said CFM. Listen to me. And I saw on top of the building and I saw it was dark. But I saw two men standing on top of that building. And in that building there was two men. But they were bigger than men. They were angels. These were principal angels. Leader angels. And I saw two of them with breastplates of gold. Shiny breastplates. And one was standing with a long trumpet, standing like this, with a trumpet on one hand and with a sword on the other hand. Dressed with gold, on a gold armor. And on the gold armor, I said, "Lord, who are these angels and what are they doing here?" And the Spirit of God told me, "Look at their breastplates." And I looked, I focused, and I saw on that one that had the tall trumpet and the big sword, which was smaller than the other angels, and I saw that it was written prophecy on his breastplate. Pay attention to what I'm going to tell you. This is the Holy Spirit speaking to CFM. And the Spirit of God told me, I have sent my spirit of prophecy over CFM. And I have sent my power over CFM. Listen to this. The second angel I saw was another angel with a golden breastplate. And he had a bigger sword, but he also had a shield, a big shield. And when I looked at his breastplate, it said power. And I started praying, and the Spirit of God told me, I have sent my angels of prophecy and of power over CFM. And some of them don't even know it. I want you to listen to this. I said, Lord, what do you want me to do? Go tell them that I put my spirit of prophecy over them and my spirit of power. Tell them that I'm waiting for them to be faithful in what I've sent and to start speaking what I give to them. I want you to listen to this. And as I was on my knees praying, the Spirit of God told me, listen to this, Lord, bless Pastor Lynn, bless his wife, bless the leaders, bless Brother Andre, bless Sister Lily, bless the children, bless Brother Harold, bless your church, Lord. This is a church of blessing. They stand on the gap for the souls. They're an evangelistic outreach mission, Lord. And the Spirit of God told me, yes, they are. This is why they are attacked. But I have sent my power angels, and they still don't understand. Listen to me. Number one, the Spirit of God told me he was going to raise up prophets. And how do you say when it's a woman that prophesizes? Prophetess. How do you say it, sister? Prophetess. Be ready. You said it. Amen. And prophetess or prophetesses. Amen. I want you to listen to this. Prophecy, I'm going to give you a definition of prophecy. Speaking inspired by the Holy Spirit. When you are in one accord, like in Pentecost, they were in one accord. They weren't worried about cars, houses, lands. They'd sell everything and they'd share it together. What's mine is yours, what yours is mine. Not what's mine is mine. Get away from it, it's mine. What's mine is yours. What's yours is mine. When you move in one agreement and one accord and one, when you move in these principles of the Spirit of God, when you move in these principles, the Spirit of God chooses you to be a messenger for him. This one is on point. I want to use this vessel because they understand the things of heaven. They understand the mutual agreement. They understand the agreement and the one accord, the one mind, the one love. I'm going to pour my spirit of prophecy so they start prophesizing to edify my church, not only in their little church, in the city where they're at. When the Lord chooses you, he sends you. And when the Lord puts his eyes over you, he's not only going to edify your church. Listen. I heard about a church in Toronto that for pandemic, they were baptizing without touching the people. 2 meters apart. All right, when I say in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, you take a dunk in the water and I'll just act like I put you in. What is this nonsense? These are big churches. Big churches. And they're playing games. Where does the Lord say that we're supposed to fear these viruses and these pandemics? Where in the Bible does the Bible teach you to fear these things? Get the fear out of your head. Fear the Lord. Fear Jesus. Fear the one that could take your soul and send it to hell. Don't fear man. And if the Lord gives you a word, don't fear man. Go and deliver it. I remember one of the first times I started delivering the word. And the Lord told me, you don't deliver this word, in the day of judgment, I'm going to call you to an account. And I will demand blood off your head if you don't deliver what I give you. I chose you to deliver what I gave you. Don't play. This is not a game. I put gifts and I put ministries. You stand up and use them firmly like you were in the world brave. You better be braver for me in the Lord. I need you to understand this part. So when the Lord sends me, I'm not scared of anyone. I'm scared of the Lord. When I'm on my knees before His presence, I'm shaking. I'm shivering. I'm sweating. Lord, have mercy over my life. The word is coming down on me. The Spirit of God is there. Lord, have mercy. Count me as worthy, Lord. And the Spirit of God is dealing with me and giving me visions and revelations and telling me, go give my word. Don't hold it back. Tell them that I will demand them for prophecy. I have put power over this church. And when He says that He's put power over you, He's saying, I gave you my Holy Spirit. Use Him. You think the Holy Spirit's for you and your comfort and your love and your being shielded and blessed? Make no mistake. He fills the whole earth. He takes you from one city and sends you to another. Be faithful in the little things. Some are faithful to stand in the ring and fight their opponents. Box and fighting, kickboxing, kung fu and whatever. When the Spirit of God sends you to your opponent in the spirit, oh, Lord, I'm scared. I can't do it. Lord, choose someone else. Don't take it for granted. If you don't do it, the Lord will send me. Hello. I go to places, I say, Lord, if there's someone holding back gifts here, they're under earth or they're put away and treasured up, here I am, Lord. Here I am. You have to be faithful in the little things. The Spirit of God told me power and anointing. And listen to what I'm going to say to the church for the leader here. The Lord showed me pillars for the church. For this church, that you have to stand with those pillars and work. You listening, Sister Megan? You have a pillar right there beside you. Give her a hug. That's one pillar. And there's your other pillar. Brother, lift your hand up, Brother Paul. That's your other pillar. These two pillars. You'll be edified when you understand those that the Lord put beside you to help you. The Lord, a house can't sustain itself with one or two pillars. You need four. You need four pillars to sustain a house. Four. You have two. And the Lord is preparing other twos. And when the Lord prepares the other two, and they're faithful and strong. And listen to this. You have advice from a marriage with these two pillars. You have advice for children. You have advice for life. You have advice in the home. You have advice in humility. You have advice in meekness. You have advice in how to work in the Lord and how to pray and He answers prayers. Ask. Sometimes we have to get closer to pillars. You know, I was beside Brother Andre here, and he was like dancing, and he's so big, he'd go boom. And I'm like, Lord, why are they all so big in CFM? I'm like trying to move in the seat, and suddenly he's like, praise God, hallelujah. Oh, my Lord, if it's not Pastor Lynn giving me a little push, it's Brother Andre. Lord, help me get bigger, man. You need to stand beside a pillar. When the earthquake comes, grab onto the pillar. You won't get shaken off. When the rivers come, you grab that pillar. It won't take you away. The currents won't take you away. You have to ask the Lord, who are the pillars? I have pillars in the church. I have elders in the church. I have old elder intercessors. I move, they move. They don't go with me, they're... Tell me every moment you're going to be preaching and ministering, and I'll be fasting and praying for you, Pastor. I have your back. Man, I'm talking 82-year-old elders. They don't all have to be young. I have pillars 26-year-old too. 26-year-olds that are heavy prayer intercessors. Amen. You need a good team. I ask the Lord, if you send people, send marriages that are solid. And if they're not solid, send couples to the youth in the church that they can become solid in the word so we can be solid marriages. One of my dreams is to grow up with Christian friends and sisters and brothers, and that we all grow old and we all grow white hair and we sit at a table and we're praising God together and opening the Bible and sharing. One of my dreams. Listen to me. The Lord knows this is one of my dreams. I said it before. My grandfather, my father's side, passed away at 50. One shot to the head in front of his whole family. My father passed away at 47. Various multiple heart attacks. He didn't take care of his health. And I'm heading to 47 in April. My father passed away at 47. It's a special year for me. And I'm taking care of my health. Ever since I met this pastor, I stopped eating sugar. I'll give you my report. I stopped eating sugar. I stopped eating rice and pasta and bread. I've been a month and a half with my wife not eating these things because I want to get fit. And I'm gonna start doing weights. And when I start doing weights, I want to stand beside Pastor Lynn and see what's going on. If I could compete, if when he starts dancing, pushes you, I'm going to stand there like, stand my ground, buddy. This pillar can't shake me off. But I say it for the glory of God. He inspires me to be edified and to change in areas. You think someone was going to come to me and tell me, man, you need to get skinny and go on a diet and this, and I would not listen. What? You need to back off. Do you even know me? I don't listen to anyone. But this guy right here, he just ministered to me. And the Spirit of God kept it here to change for the benefit of my family, for the benefit of the church, for the benefit of the gospel. And you have to give honor where they deserve honor. But you give honor too. If the Lord edifies you in something, if the Lord speaks to you, you know what pushes me to prophesy more? You know what pushes me to prophesy more? When you recognize that the Lord spoke to you through me. I go back home and I cry and I say, Lord, you're allowing me to be a worthy vessel to speak your word. And I cry in gratitude. I say, thank you, Lord, for hearing the report and the blessing. I'm going to finish right now. The Lord showed me two angels, spirit of prophecy and the spirit of power over that building of CFM. And I want you to know that the Lord is waiting, pushing. I saw the angel standing firm, ready for war. But they were waiting for someone to say, here I am, use me. I could teach you through the word that there's a spirit of prophecy and the spirit of power. I could take you to the word one-on-one and teach you. Amen. But you have to be sensitive to the spirit. The Lord will not use you if you're always cussing and cursing and sucking your teeth. Maybe you won't say it, but you're sucking your teeth like, what? Kissing your teeth and sucking them and making these expressions that are not right. Even in those expressions, the Lord is testing you. Nah, they're not ready for it. They're not ready for it. They have to sanctify themselves. Isaiah had an experience in the throne of God, around the throne of God. And when he was there, the first thing he felt was remorse and repentance. Because he lived with people of dirty lips. And he said, I'm not worthy. I'm not worthy, Lord. I'm not worthy. Let me step over here. I want to minister to this sister right here. I'm not worthy. I'm not worthy. Listen to what the Lord told me. What's your name? Penny. That's your name? This is what the Lord told me. The Lord told me, I'm going to make a change of name in you. Because when they call you Penny, they're calling you a cent. They're looking down on you. But before my eyes, the Spirit of God told me, before my eyes, you're precious. Listen to this, Brother Paul. Before my eyes, you have value. And where I took you out of, I showed you what value is. Listen to this. Despised by men and despised by the world, I put a pillar beside you. I put a man of God beside you to give you value. And in that value, I'm going to take you and raise you up to give value to others. Hug this sister. Hug this sister right here. To give value to others and cover them. And teach them the meaning of value. Teach them the meaning of being appreciated in life. Because when you're not appreciated and you've been through so much in the street, hey, the gang life here in Montreal is crazy, like it or not. The gang life, the drug life, prostitution is crazy here in Montreal. And I know the Lord has brought people here to cleanse them from these areas. And he will bring much more. But if the Lord allows these gang members to come and people to walk in these gangs and prostitution and crazy things in life, it's because he wants to shame Christians that think they're wise. Hello? He wants to shame those that think that they're already puffed up and they think they're already made. And the Lord calls the despicable, the dirty, the wounded, the hurt, the low life, the garbage mentality to teach them royal mentality. And he chooses the worst to put them and exalt them and teach them in humility so the Lord can be an example to others that they can come out of that world too. The Lord told me he was going to change your name, and your name should be changed instead of Penny to Precious Pearl. But Brother Paul chooses if he wants to call you his pearl or not. That's up to him. I'm just saying what the Lord ministered to me while I was on my knees seeking the dew of Hermon. And the Spirit of the Lord told me I'm going to raise this woman up and that man up as pillars in this ministry. And they will be alive. There is testimonies hidden in this couple. Listen to me. There is testimonies hidden amongst this marriage that is a powerhouse to other marriages, that is of a huge blessing to others. And the Lord will bring couples and bring marriages and form marriages. And these two will be the example. They will be the leading role in the marriages. You heard that? Amen? Let them lead. Let them teach the marriages. Let them speak about what they've been through. This is what glorifies the Lord. I ashamed myself in things I go through for God to be glorified. Let me be crushed down. Let him be exalted. And that's the way others learn in the ministry. The Spirit of God told me he was good. Listen to this. He will move you from this place. He will move you from this place. This place is too hidden. If this wouldn't be, I'm telling you, this would be double the people that are here. I assure you people couldn't get in. They don't know where it's at. It's a very hidden place. But the Lord wants to exalt CFM in Montreal. He wants to exalt the church and put him in a bigger place. And I know the Lord will do it. It will come through. It will come through. But we have to believe it and tell the Lord, Lord, send us to the right place. I know a few pastors around St. Laurent here. I know a few around here. I know the Lord is going to do what he has to do. No doubt. I don't doubt it. Let the Spirit of God do what he has to do. I want you to close your eyes where you're at. I want you to raise your right hand up. And I want you to say with me, Father, to use me with power, with anointing. I want you to use me with prophecy. I want you to anoint me to speak your word. in the powerful name of Jesus, that you anoint me to speak new tongues, that you anoint me in the name of Jesus, that you deliver me out of any disobedience, and that you cleanse me in the powerful name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' mighty name. I'm going to stop right here. I want you to, if you can, stand up on your feet. I want to make a calling. Before I leave, I want to make a calling. The Spirit of God, listen to me. The Spirit of God wants to anoint you with power and prophecy. One of the desires of Apostle Paul was that everyone should prophesize. I wish that all of you would prophesize. Don't let anyone hold you back from speaking the word of God. You know when the changes come? When our mouths are delivered to the Lord and our tongues speak His will. Not our will, His will. I want to make a calling. And first, it's for the church and those visitors. If you haven't accepted Jesus, I want to make a calling to you to accept Jesus. If you've been walking in Jesus and you want to reconcile or walk in the power of Jesus, this calling is for you. If you've been walking with one foot in and one foot out, you need to reconcile. You need to repent. You need to amend your ways and walk in integrity before the Lord. The Lord is calling you to walk in integrity and loyalty. Maybe you've been wounded in the past. You know, there's moments I've been wounded too. Our church has been divided. We've been through divisions. We've had the church full. It's become empty again. And the Lord has put me before the dividers, those that left, those that persecuted, those that spoke bad about me. And you know what I did? I forgave them. I told them, I forgive you. I love you. The church doors are still open waiting for you to come back whenever you want. I didn't shoot you out. You left alone. You got to have a heart. You have to have Jesus to be able to forgive those that speak all sorts of bad and evil against you. You have to be born again. And I'm telling you today, the Lord wants to anoint you. He wants to put spiritual weapons in your hands, in your spirit. This calling is for those that want those two angels that I saw in that revelation. For those that want those two angels, those two spirits, to use you as a vessel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Through His Holy Spirit, this calling is for you. Is there anyone willing? Is there anyone willing to say, Lord, use me to prophesize. Use me to be a messenger. Use me to speak your word with authority and with power, Lord. This calling is for the church. If you feel you have to come to the front, I want to pray for you.